And as you all know, the theme is big, boost sales, increase profits, and grow opportunities. And I think that the first day proves that we're well on our way to achieving those goals. We have a great few days that are scheduled out for you, a great trade show. We have a full trade show, 100% full. And before we get started, I'm going to introduce Brent here in a minute to introduce, to talk about a few things and also introduce our keynote speaker for tonight. But I'd like to recognize a few people before we get started. One person I'd like to recognize is John Albright, who's the Vice Chair of the Board. John, thank you for all the work you've done this year. Tom Skaggs, Treasurer of IPI, thank you. You guys can hold your applause till the end. Yeah, stand up, John and Tom. Kobe Marawelli, who is the Secretary of IPI. Neil Hooverston, Board Member. Frank DiStefano, Larry Steiner, and our two newest members who you elected this year, Marcia Phillips and Joel Miller. Could you all stand up? And let's show them some appreciation. And believe me, they work for you 365 days a year. We have several committees on the board that not only their board work, they volunteer to do other things for IPI, and believe me, it's a lot of gratitude that I say that I appreciate all their help this year, and I know the staff does also. I'd like to recognize a few other people that are here today. We have past DEMA President Chris Lytle. Chris, you want to stand up? Also past DEMA President Michael St. Germain. Michael? Past PMA President Don Spring from Canada, one of our Canadian members. Past PMA President and also past IPI Chairman Alan Showalter. Is there? Somewhere in the room. Past IPI Chair and current PMA President Brian Wood. Brian? Brian left the PMA show in Australia and got here yesterday. So he's dedicated to the cause here, believe me. I'd also like to recognize some of our past chairmen of IPI that have paved the way for me and all of us and made IPI what it is today. Past Chairman Randy McRae. Randy, you want to stand up? If you're in the room. Randy, thank you. Past Chairman John Perchelin. John is here somewhere. Hey, John, back there. Of course, the two that you've already clapped about, John Albright and Neil Hooverston, stand up. They were past chairman of the organization. I'd also like to recommend some special guests that are here. We have Bill McCurry, who is the Mr. Guru for everybody. Bill, want to stand up? Hello, Bill. We also have from IPS in Australia two individuals who now we have an alliance with them down there, and hopefully this over the next few years is really going to be produce some results for us and get some real synergism between the people down under and us. We have Stuart Holmes and Rob Voicy. Would you stand up? And if you have some time, talk to these guys, because I'll tell you what, they have some great ideas and they want to hear from you. And hopefully they'll get a lot of people interested in IPI down under. We do have, obviously Alan and Catherine and some of the other people from Australia. I think we have, Peter, you're here, right? Peter Michael, are you here? Yeah, Peter's here. So we have some people from Australia. We have a bunch of Canadian people. Now, speaking about Canadians, we have Harris Korn and Brian Griffin from Photosource that are here. You guys want to stand up? Are you here in the room? Yeah. they're here trying to learn what's going on in the industry. Also, I'd like to recognize our staff. Now, believe me, without our staff, trust me, none of this could happen. And we have one of the hardest working staffs of any organization in the United States. And we have Ron Mahoney, Brenda DiVincenzo, stand up, Fran Boyer, and Karen Wilmot. Karen? Thank you for all your hard work. We appreciate everything you do for us as members. We also have Tom Crawford, Paul Rince, and Bob Rowland, who are on staff people also, but they're more of people that work with us on as we need. Would you stand up, you guys? Tom Crawford over here. Bob, are you here? Paul Rince back there. Yep, they're our consultants. And believe me, without them, a lot of this couldn't happen. And I'll tell you what, we're moving forward with a lot of neat ideas, and believe me, they're helping us out with those things. Now, I want to, before our keynote speaker, I want to introduce to you guys the executive director of IPI, and this man works, if there were 390 days in a year, this guy would be working 390 days. I get emails and texts from this guy at 11:30 at night. He never stops working for you, believe me, and I'm just not saying that, but this guy is Mr. IPI, Brent Boyer. Howdy. Recently, I returned from The Biggest Loser. For all of you that have said they were worried about getting me a get well card, I am fine. Everything's good. Fran and I started 14 months ago with some personal trainers. Her name starts with a J, Juliet or Julian. Yeah. Huh? Yeah. But anyway, the personal training thing, anybody that's never done that before, it is amazing. As you can see, the results, I mean, you know, from the weight we lift and from the diet that we've been on, that's really, really amazing, and I would highly recommend it to anybody. But yeah, we're probably more fit than I've been in the last 30 years. And one of the reasons is I see a huge opportunity in the United States, and really for that matter around the world, for the independent service specialty retailer. And I felt that if we were going to be leading the race, we needed to have somebody out in front that could really run it hard. And I want to do that. So I'm going to run hard and I want everybody in this room and all those that are not in this room that couldn't make it to be able to win that race and have very successful businesses. So anyway, a couple of announcements. First one is this meeting is being live streamed around the world on the World Wide Web, which I think is pretty daggone cool. You know, I've had my picture on there before, but I'm not sure any video. There's no YouTube videos about me that I know of anyway. But anyway, just to let you know that this is being streamed and recorded, or whatever the appropriate terminology is, around the world, and I just wanted to let everybody know about that. A couple other housekeeping things before we move on. One is evaluation and feedback. Please, please, please fill out your evaluations. Give us feedback if you want to even do an extra page of them. That's okay. We need that to help us make this meeting better every year, and so far I think we've been able to accomplish that. Another reminder, also on Wednesday, be sure to wear your black IPI shirt. It's critical for the picture so that we get everybody in the picture looking the same, and we will ask for you to remove your name tags before the picture, so just keep that in mind. So please, on Wednesday, wear your black shirts. The cool thing this year is attendance. Attendance is up almost 15%. The past four, which is great. You guys,
The past few years, I think we've been kind of stagnant. In fact, in one year, we had a little bit down, but I think this year, people are really seeing the value of the content and what we have to offer, and I think that's just outstanding that you guys have made the effort and the dedication with the $10 a bag fee and the $4 seatbelt fee and everything else they charge today to get you on the plane. I really appreciate and I applaud you all for making that effort. Thank you. Thank you for coming. So I'm just going to talk here for just a few minutes, and what I want to do is I want to talk about vision. I want to talk about some of the things that I'm seeing that are important, and then turn it over to the real expert. Dave Guidry is an IPI member. He has a lot to share with you that I think is extremely relevant. You may remember a couple years ago we had Ross Schaefer here, and he talked about being relevant to your customer. Well, David's going to show us all ways that we can continue to be relevant and grow our business. But anyway, title of the presentation, I've changed this three times, and in fact, I changed it just the other day. The reason I did is last week I was at Six Site up in San Jose, and I was able to take part in a focus group, and it was pretty cool. We had a consultant called the Technology Tailor from Chicago that was there, a guy by the name of Alex Golden. And in the focus group was Ritz Camera, and these were the senior management people of these organizations. Ritz was there, Microsoft was there, Siwi was there, Costco, Kodak, Lucidium, HP, and IPI. We're keeping pretty good company nowadays. But the interesting thing, or the takeaways from the focus group, were this, and it was about a 2-hour thing that we are going to repeat again, and I think we're probably going to repeat it in about 6 months. And this was courtesy of Six Site, and very helpful. But anyway, the three takeaways I have, and this is the reason I changed the title. This one was, everybody was concerned about how to monetize those things that are in the long tail. How to get an ROI on the things that are in the long tail. How can we implement these niche products and these niche business segments and monetize them and really make money on them? The people that had senior management of public companies, they were really interested in that because they have a tremendous amount of pressure on them. But the first takeaway was how to monetize the long tail. Second takeaway was that there's just way too much legacy thinking in our industry. What they were saying was that this prevents strategic thinking and promotes defensive thinking and will never make any progress with our legacy thinking in the past. And they seem to think everybody was pretty guilty of that. Still back, not really moving forward with where we need to be in terms of opportunities today. And they also talked about that as a group, we generally, or they concluded that as a group, we rely too much on talking to the customer about the products and not marketing enough to the customer, which I think really, really validated our IPI Marketing Solutions program, the fact that we rolled that out last year. I just was sitting there and said, man, this is great timing. But anyway, the final, those were the three takeaways, and all these fit under the umbrella of think big. The focus group instructor talked about Zappos thinking big and Amazon thinking big and the results that's produced for those companies. So anyway, let's talk about vision for just a second. If you'll remember, the IPI vision statement says that IPI will be a resource for businesses in the image archiving business. And let's talk about IPI as that resource for a moment. Our history goes back to 1982, and in 1982, the world was different, much different than it is today. In the beginning, we were heavily focused upon got a number of buttons to push here and pages to flip, sorry. We were focused, of course, upon the purchasing cooperative part of IPI. IPI is a purchasing co-op. It was critical back then, but it was a very important back then, or critical back then and very important today. And then three things happened to the industry. Since those days, three things happened. First of all, the game changed. The game changed considerably. We went from film to digital media. We went from wet to dry. We went from an analog communications to a digital electronic communication. Today we have Facebook, we have Twitter, we have Foursquare, we have email, and we're really moving from an internet-centric society to a mobile-centric society. Talked about that a lot at SixSite last week, where many of the people were saying that we'll look up in 5 years and you won't be accessing the internet on your desktop anymore. It'll all be on your mobile device, whether it's a tablet or a smartphone, something of that nature. So the changes are continuing. Another, after that first change, that being the game, the second one is 57. Anybody have any idea what that is? It's not Heinz's variety. It's the average age of an IPI member today. Some of us are much older than that. But some of us are younger too, because it is an average. But we gathered this information with the census survey that Brenda did, and so the second change is that we're 57 today. So if this is our 29th anniversary this year, the average age when we started was 28. Right. So things have changed a little bit. The third change, and kind of as a result of those other two, is we're looking for an exit strategy from the business. And there are a couple of options. One is turn off the lights, lock the door, and walk away. Hopefully, IPI can prevent everybody from ever considering that. We're on a mission that even if you can sell your business to any person for a dollar, just $1, it's better than you turn off the lights and walking away from the thing. And that's one of our goals. Another option is to sell to friends and family or others. Now, friends and family may not be friends and family after you sell it, but but there is that opportunity, and that's something that you can't disregard. Hopefully maybe another generation takes over, or you have a close friend that you can sell it to. With either of these, we need a strategy. And that brings us back to vision. And in the vision category, with the addition of Ron this past year and a full staff, only missing a marketing director, I've had more time to do what I talk about a lot to you all, and that's work on the business, not in the business. It's given me time to really compile some of the things that I'm seeing around the world, for that matter. I was going to say the country, but I picked up a lot whenever I was in Australia just a few weeks ago from Stuart and Rob, a lot of good ideas down there. Picked up a lot of the CWE connection that we're going to be talking about tomorrow and that you're seeing here now. Part of that is because of trips to Photo Keen and things like that. But we need a vision, and I've had the opportunity to work on the business and think about where we needed to be going or where you all needed to be going and how we can help you get there in running the race. Several months ago, I presented my vision to the board, and today we're here to present that vision and its practical implementation to you all. As an IPI member, you have an exclusive opportunity to raid the IPI cupboard. Anybody know what a cupboard is? That's not West Virginia. Is Pat Dodd in here? Where's Pat Dodd? Pat Dodd, fellow Charlestonian. You know what a cupboard is, don't you, Pat? Anyway, I envision the IPI cupboard. And think in your mind's eye, you're in the IPI store and there's a cupboard, and in that cupboard, there are jars. There are 25 jars. And in each one of those jars is $20,000 to $40,000 in gross sales. And as an IPI member, you can go up to pick off any of those jars you want. You can open the jar up, and in that jar is a recipe. And in that recipe is how to make that $20,000 to $40,000. It's very, you know, and the very simple math is if you select all 25 jars, you got a $500,000 store. Anybody think they can make money if they're generating $500,000 in gross sales in service business? On the other side of that is, if you generate $40,000 out of each one of those jars, you're gonna have $1 million business. And with that $1 million business, I suspect you're gonna be very, very profitable. So that's kind of the vision. Another way to look at this is, another way to look at the jars is jobs. And jobs are more, is an acronym for jars of business segments. So we're going to be talking about that, and then, and that these jars of business segments really provide you with an exit strategy. It's turning around. For those desiring to sell to family and friends, or just as important, I think, for new entrepreneurial people that want to get into our business. I think that there will be people, I know there are people out there today that know nothing about our industry, but want to own their own business, and they want to be an image archiving of some nature or the other. So I think that, that this vision, this strategy provides that opportunity. The first example of a jar that we had was last year when we introduced the IPI Marketing Solutions Program. It was a turnkey solution with a recipe and a jar that was full of cash. If you implemented every bit of that program, I'm almost willing to bet that you generated close to $40,000 in sales last year. It's pretty much a no-brainer. But today, what we're going to talk about is the IPI Development Labs, which is really the what everybody else in the office likes to call jars. They didn't like my word of jars. So they came up with the word or the term IPI Development Labs, and at this meeting we're introducing 3.5 jars in the form of IPI Development Labs. The IPI Development Labs we're introducing, one is custom framing. You've seen the setup out here in the big hall demo. We're also introducing video archiving, which we've kind of introduced before in the past. And the other big one is sports photography, which we introducing this year. All these are jars that we think will provide you with niche opportunities to grow your business if you're not already in them. You're probably wondering what the half is, the 3.5. Well, the half one is one that many of you attended today. How many people went to the professional photo or personal photo organizing? Would y'all like that? That's the half jar. It's not quite built out yet, but we're working on it. As I said, you know, it's a work in progress. With Ron on staff, he's been able to help us develop these and flesh them out. And with Brenda on staff, with her organization skills, she's been able to develop a blueprint or the cookbook or the recipe, if you will, and organize it so that you can manage the development of each one of these jars. So, bottom line. We see this as the vision for the next several years. We'll continue to be introducing jars, and we'll be continuing to introduce the recipe so that you'll have a turnkey approach to being able to add gross sales to your business, and we think profitable gross sales to your business. That's the idea. We'll be year or two, we'll ultimately get all 25 of these introduced. Some will fall out, some will be added. Maybe 25 is not the right number. Maybe it's 20, maybe it's 30. We're not really sure, but we're not going to let those types of things stand in our way of developing new ones. We're not set on any number, but what we are set on is providing you all, and those even that aren't here, with the opportunity to grow your sales and increase your profitability. That's our aim, that's our vision, that's our goal. Thank you. So with that, I'd like to, you need a hookup there, Dave?
Yep.
Sorry.
Let's see what happens. Wake up.
I got problems.
It was working before.
Yeah. Am I getting close to the play button? Not even. I can't see. Hold on.
Do you want me to go left, right?
Yeah, but it'd look bad.
Well, Dave's hooking this up.
Can you hear me? All right.
Anyway, as you all know, David is an IPI member, and over the past year and a half, he's given a presentation to a couple of different groups with regard to redefining the work that we do and how to be successful with that work. We thought it was very timely with the introduction of our vision and the things that we're working on for David to come and talk to all of us this afternoon. Hopefully, he'll be able to.
Yeah, we'll get there.
Is it me?
I got it.
There you go.
Sorry about that.
It was Dave Guidry.
Okay. Hey, thanks for having me, everybody. I got 3 kids under 6, and I slept like a champ. Great. So I'm a second-generation owner-operator out of New Orleans, and I'm here to talk about redefining the work we do. I think it was about 20 years ago that I attended my first pro convention and kind of said, well, this wouldn't be too bad to get involved with. Of course, nothing that was attractive to me then exists for us today, but we can make it, you know. At any rate, I've been born and raised in New Orleans, and I operate 2 photo specialty camera shops, one in Metairie, Louisiana, and one in Mandeville. So I just to review what we talked about, there certainly has been a tremendous amount that changed. Essentially, the industry that put me through college and gave us our standard of living and let us perpetuate a family-owned business for 38 or 39 years now was based on a simple premise that you push the button, you record the things that are important to you, and then we do the rest. This was, of course, George Eastman's statement. And I want to point out what a strong contrast we have today. For those of you, I imagine that most of you are offering photo books in your stores today, right? The thing about photo books is when people see a well-executed photo book, they love it. There's no ambivalence about it. They immediately start to identify, well, I could do this with this, or I could do a cookbook, or I could do something like this for my family. They're very excited about the product. And then you swing into exactly how we can make that for them. So we hand them a software or point them to a website. We tell them to go learn a software, which is essentially what you're doing. We tell them to pretend that they're a designer, even though they've never engaged a design project before. We ask them to work several hours. I mean, creating a photo book can be a life-sucking event unless you're really passionate about it. And then once they get it all the way that they want it, and they're satisfied that it's perfect because we don't want to have to redo once you've said you wanted this, then you give it to us and we'll be your output person. You give it to us and we'll print it. And unfortunately, I think that that model is going to limit the amount of uptake we can have. There is so much resistance, so much time poverty out there to getting these jobs, we have to find a new way to do it. Furthermore, the wind is in our face in another way. Not only have we lost Kodak as the great yellow father for our industry, but we lost the primary voice that was out there buying media, talking about picture taking as an activity that in and of itself is worthwhile and pleasing. The only thing that's out there on a media right now, a mass media, are from the camera manufacturers. And if you notice, the camera manufacturers come at it from a far different angle. They're talking about the technology and the capture. They are not talking about the preservation and enjoyment of picture taken on its own. So at the top, we've got a vacuum in even telling people that this is a pursuit that's worthwhile. Furthermore, the great yellow father is flat out dead. I mean, I don't need them to sell me Dektol. I don't need their solutions. They are completely irrelevant. And I don't think there's a single Kodak brand product in my store. Not because I'm angry with Kodak for any reason, but that's how much things have changed. So we don't have them as cheerleaders. We don't have big budgets. And I think that this is the best way to put it. The future's here. We are it, and we are on our own. Now, this is good because it means that within your own sphere of influence, your own neighborhood, your own company, your customers, you can find things that are important to them, that are desirable to them, and you can differentiate a little bit, which is important. But if we're on our own, one of the things that we need to recognize is that the business model has changed. So when we had the great yellow father looking out for us, we also had mini labs where we produced many from many. Very transactional in nature. For a long period of time, we had the roll of film. It was an unnaturally long period of stability. We could purchase equipment that functioned the way it did on day one. It functioned that way in year 10. Other than APS, which was a minor blip in the long continuum of where we were, we got the same size cartridge with the same medium, and we got two visits from them every 36 snaps. Now it's gone. The fulfillment that we provided, we held the key to the magic. Now the key to the magic is on the back of the LCD screen. We have to create and invent a different kind of magic. And this really is the difference between just promoting a service that you do that people need or attracting a customer to things that we make. They're very different. When I'm going to talk about raising the average sale, because I don't like to talk too much theoretical stuff without giving you practical things about what I think needs to happen for my company, and I suspect that you'll find that you're very similar. When the digital revolution came about and we first started to see major players on the scene that began to drop the price on 4x6 prints, for example, our unit of choice was the 4x6 print. We were getting 40 cents a piece at the end of film. We are at 29 cents today. Most people in this room would say that I'm insanely high for the market we're in. But you can look at any photographic paper products. Almost without fail, most of us raced to the bottom and depressed the price because we felt like if we just matched the big boys online, we'd be able to generate store traffic. So even if we had to sacrifice our core unit, we'd at least get store traffic out of it. But a lot of the assumptions, as you well know, were dead wrong. The fact of the matter is it wasn't 9-cent prints or isn't 9-cent prints driving it anymore. They don't need two prints of everything. Our system was built on waste. It is defunct. It is not necessary. So what we have to do now is raise the average sale, and I'll tell you how that can be done, and it can be done. That's another piece of good news. I think it is very possible today for someone to enter either of my location with the intent of making some photographic prints, and depending on who they run into or which questions they ask or whether or not we're on the ball, that customer, that transaction can turn into an $18 kiosk ticket if we're lucky. Add that up for 29 cents. It takes a little bit to get to 18 bucks. We could have that, or if we're aware and we have surrounded the place with products that are a higher price point, we may be able to step in and turn that into something else and more appealing, something else that's more appealing. So from the same, it is entirely possible for a customer to walk into Lakeside Camera and either spend 18 bucks or spend $500. And the fact of the matter is that in the cases in which we get them to spend $500, they ultimately are happier. For real. Because the product is valid and desirable and authentic and well-made and so on. One example of this would be, we know that there, I thought, what did they say today? Some kind of mom, they call them rebel moms. What was the thing we heard today? It was pretty funny. Mamarazzis? Okay, that makes sense to me. How many people are seeing photographers shoot a wedding and turn over the disc to your bride? Right? It happens all the time, right? If we allow them to sit at the kiosk, any kiosk that we have, and begin to make prints, because a wedding is one in which someone is likely to think, I would like to visit a specialist for this. So you're likely to run across them. I would like to visit a specialist for this. It is entirely possible, if left alone, that one of my salespeople would guide the bride who holds a disc to the biggest day of her life to a kiosk, offer them coffee or water, make said coffee or water, run them through a tutorial on how to do the thing, and then feel like they did a great job in ringing them up for $9.27 for the images that they want. If we're paying attention, and we're aware, and we have made our samples properly, it's also entirely possible that we might say, hey, I see you printing pictures of a wedding. Have you thought about doing a book? And that's where your $500 thing comes in. So I'm going to foreshadow something I'm going to tell you about later, but the day that you sell a $500 book, you need to plan to put in an $800 book. And when you sell the $800 book, you need to put in a $1,500 book. That's partially how we're going to raise the average sale. Now, the 25 jars that Brent talked about, I get that. There's a ton of things that we have to touch. There's a ton of things that need refinement. Big on my list right now is video, and Ginger's attended a video thing this afternoon. She's here with me. I think that we have somehow gone on autopilot with this idea that we're going to take video cassettes and transfer them to DVD and our job is done. How many of you own an iPad? Is it entirely possible that if you went to get something transferred and the sales associate said, do you have an iPad? And you said, yes. Would you like us to prepare a version for viewing on your iPad for an additional, how much? $20? That person might say yes. And in doing that, we then take them and have them use the video and enjoy it and share it more, maybe prompting more memory preservation activities, right? So I'm looking at what we do with video. It's a nice, nice business segment. We're doing some custom stuff. We're doing a lot of video transfer stuff. We're also leaving a tremendous amount of money on the table. I mean, I should feel shame sitting up here at how much we let walk. I kid you not. And we're going to fix it. How are we going to fix it? Well, we can't, unfortunately or fortunately, depending on how you look at it, we can't fix everything at once. So we have begun to rely on a quarterly theme. And if you've ever done a quarterly theme where you say, hey, this is what we're going to focus on, I might not even term it specifically as a quarterly theme, but one of the things I wanted to attack at the beginning of this year coming out of the February Pro meeting was how many times I see people come to our store because it is a special image, because the image itself is important, they come to a specialist. We then produce a very, very high quality print at a price that's higher than most of you are probably comfortable charging. And yet we let that customer walk out the door and we've got a full framing facility. Why did it keep happening? Why did it keep happening? We talked to the staff. We went through training until finally we realized, you know, whatever it was, whatever the totality of our investment in trying to get people to frame the things that we made for them, it wasn't good enough. So we had to go back to the drawing board. So one of the things we looked at was how are we going to change the discussion? And by change the discussion, I mean if photo specialty or photo shops in general are thought of as the place I used to get my 4x6s done, we need to reposition that entirely in people's minds. We've got to change the discussion about who we are. And remember, this is about raising the average sale. So I'm a camera shop, and I've always had some ready-made frames. Our model, much like I was telling you about how we would get someone to make a book, is, hey, this is a wonderful print. Why don't you look for a frame? Well, at that point, the check is already paid. They may not want to go search out. They don't know what a good frame is. We thought, well, there's got to be a better way. So we stepped back and said, you know what? We are not a custom framer. That's not what my camera shop, photo specialty shop is. A custom framer is a one or two person operation where you go in and you pick out molding that's right for you and you return 3 or 4 weeks later hoping that it's ready, right? That's not what I want to be. I want to redefine the game. I want to change the discussion. So we said, first, we got to be fast. We start stocking moldings. You can make a lot more money stocking moldings that you can turn real fast than you can stocking cameras. Take that from a guy who moves a lot of cameras. So rather than leave it to chance that they might find their own frame and put it in, we said, what do we really do here? What we really do, while we frame posters like New Orleans Jazz Fest posters, and we do frame artwork, sometimes we frame canvases that we make, and sometimes we frame things that are not ours. They may be objects, shadow boxes, so we have full capability. If you want gold leaf, we got gold leaf. That's what you want. But that's not the majority of the people we serve. For us, the first requirement was to pick out a frame line that was had a higher quality perception and feel than the ready-mades that we were buying, something that could be exclusive to us. We had to create a system that would be simple for the staff to understand so that they could convey it to other people. And we wanted the photo to be the star. And that's one thing I think I'd like to put a stake in the ground for all of you. We are photo people. I'm not saying we can't scan children's artwork and ticket stubs and all those things, but fundamentally, we are photo specialists. So we wanted to come up with a batch of frames that could honor the photograph simply and would work in most decor. So we went to the drawing board, began to call it a mix and match collection. We settled on, this is what it was like. So first we went to the drawing board, we said, look, we're going to solve the framing problem. First we went to the drawing board and laid out some things that made sense. One of the ways I wanted to change the discussion is that framing is for a single image to be featured in a single frame. No, we want to show more multi-opening frames than we do single opening frames. So we want to change that discussion. The second thing we found out is that you just can't engage the mental calculator. We wanted to change the discussion from do you need a frame for this print to how about we frame a wall? Let's take it away from the single unit and talk about the wall. How are we going to talk about the wall? We got to represent it. We got to have collateral to do it. And on top of that, to show someone a wall full of frames, the first question that they always ask if they find it appealing is, how much is it? What does it cost me to do this? It looks really nice. Is it a $5,000 investment? Is it a $50 investment? I don't know. So part of the strategy was not to engage the mental calculator. You can look at a wall of frames and get a single price. You buy a certain amount of frames, we discount the price. And we show many examples. Now, to get back to the kids' artwork, sure, we want to mix kids' artwork in. We want to display as if it were in someone's home. If you look at the couch there, that's done on phototext. Most of you print on phototext that can be positioned and repositioned. So if you needed to sort of simulate someone's room, I mean, we're not Pottery Barn. We don't sell couches. We can certainly kind of show you what it might look like by printing our own couches and end tables and things like that. And then we give people the tools, if they wanted to do a wall, to put all this stuff together. So again, depending on the collection and depending on how we laid it out, we give you one price to buy the whole wall if that's what you want. But each frame is also labeled with its own price. And when I say don't engage the mental calculator, here's what I'm talking about. In the old days when canvas first came out, we said, well, here's how much it is to print the canvas. And this is how much it is if you want it stretched. If you want to add the wire, it's this much. And after a while, the consumer starts to say, wait a minute, I better think about this. And if they got to think about it, they're gone. They're already gone. So we had to find a way to compress all pricing information as best as we could into one bundle so that we do not engage the mental calculator. We arrive at a price that's good for us. Hopefully it's a value to most customers, and then we go with it. Now here's the thing about consumers, and I'm going to go back to some of this mix and match collection. They want to be thrilled with possibilities. They don't want to be told no for anything. They need to come into my locations or visit my web and say, wow, anything that I can think of, these people can help me with, right? And when you walk into my main location, if you haven't been in there, and you're a photographer, and you see, or let's just say you're a regular person with a family and you want to buy a new camera, it's very easy for people to get overwhelmed. Oh my goodness, this is a place for professionals or whatever have you. They come in, we want them to be thrilled, we want them to be moving through a wonderland of neat things that they can do with their photographs, but there's a cardinal rule. You cannot confuse the customer. Anytime we put barriers between our products and a decision to adopt, we kill it. So how do we not confuse when we've got this huge array of products? I don't know about you guys, but since we adopted working with David Gross from Condi, the amount of SKUs and items that we produce, I mean, just think about having to deliver these in package boxes. It's turned into a real challenge. A good one, but a real challenge. So how do we not confuse them? Well, I have sort of settled on the power of three. This is a display that we use to sell fine art papers. Now for us, we use the Hanamuel fine art papers. We use three types. We use the German etching. We suggest that for antique photos and maybe art reproduction because it's a little off-white and it's got a texture. There's plenty of stuff out there. Don't worry about particularly what we use. Then there's the photo Barretta, which is more like a fiber-based, glossy type of brilliant color print. And then there's photo rag, which is a matte-looking print without the texture of German etching. So we made those decisions. We said these three papers, we can make great prints with them, and we'll give you a choice, what looks like infinite choice. We'll give you three choices. That seems to be the number that I used to arrive at when somebody would come in to look at a camera and they'd have no idea which camera they wanted to buy. If you put 10 models on the counter, you're going to lose that sale or lose one of the cameras. All right? So it's bad. Either way, too much choice is bad. All the choice in the world is desirable, but too much choice is bad. So we use the power of three. Well, with the power of three, if you look at the entire framing collection that we did, they are identical molding, with the exception that one is white, one is brown, and one is black. Photo is a star, simple frames, right? Now, we have matte choices as well. All the choices you want for the mix and match collection. Off-white, white, and black. Power of three, okay? So this massive frame deployment system that we put out really relies on three basic components at almost each step of the way. So then we started to augment them with other things like photo shelves. You put a tile on the photo shelf, and all of a sudden, the tiles that we were selling that are inherently desirable, they look good. People say, wow, how did you do that? But what do you do with it? What do you put it on? Well, first we got little stands. Now we show how you can create a wall. Furthermore, the framing choices that we made for this collection, we made them consciously deciding that someone could buy one of these but also buy most of the ready-made frames that we already stock, and they wouldn't clash too bad. These are neutral, well-made, photo-is-the-star frames, and we keep them in stock so that if you require something framed now, you can have it with a custom mat, no matter what. So that was this year's quarterly theme. Well, the beginning, you only get really three quarterly themes a year because you won't really execute that good. So if you get, you know, if you got four quarters, if you can really pull off two major endeavors in a year, you're probably doing well. So with framing, we looked at it and said, all right, we're really going to attack this thing. That meant painting walls. That meant putting up displays. That meant sourcing stuff. We laid it out as a business plan from the ground up. And it was so, well, you know, are we really selling more frames? Well, 41% up this month over last month in framing over last year. And some of this stuff hasn't even fully been realized in the consumer forum. We're learning on the back end and implementing, but they haven't caught on yet. When they catch on, I will be stocking frames in the upstairs storage part of my company in order to fulfill demand during Christmas. These are frames. Frames. This is not exotic. Frames. The growth is there. Part of how we got it, though, was not that system, necessarily. It wasn't that everyone's bought 41% more of what we were selling before with that mix and match collection. It's that we provided the right amount of cues in theater. You cannot walk into Lakeside Camera today and have it not dawn on you that we frame things. Okay? You cannot come in and not gain the understanding that we frame things. You also cannot come in and not get the idea that it's appropriate and cool to frame more than one image in a frame. So we are changing the discussion. We also get people thinking about their walls, spaces in their homes, instead of individual units that sell for $30. We have changed the discussion, we have raised the bar, and in the process, we are raising the average sale. The lowest price frame in that mix and match collection is about a 10 by 10, and it sells for $49 with the print. That's a conscious decision. So cues and theater. And then there's this thing that has cropped up where, like I was talking about the photo books, if we expect that people are going to drive our business and give us volume based on the work that they do, and then they treat us like an advanced, more capable output bureau, then we're naturally going to be limited in the amount of books we have the opportunity to print, because most people just don't have time, they don't have the inclination, they don't feel confident, they don't want to learn the software, all those things. So I think we are moving into a new era of do it with me, one that is not transactional in nature, where you give me something and tell me what you want to come out, what you would like to have back, but one in which you come to me with an idea and we help you execute on what your vision might be. And both parties in that dance have a discussion in how it will come out. So how many of you have an iPhone, right? How many suspect that point-and-shoot camera sales may be impacted by cell phones? All right. I had that same thought. I'm gonna show you some videos here, and I'm not gonna make them too long. It's some home video stuff, but I wanna just kinda shift what you think a little bit about what this means to us. Before, we would sell video cameras for people to go do video. Now, people are leading their lives. If they want to get a clip, they can get a clip. How do we remain relevant? We can't sell the device. We can't play in the ecosystem. I mean, you could write an app if you want to, but we don't really have an invitation to play in that ecosystem. So where are we relevant? Well, that's my six-year-old. She has a talent I never had. And I got home from work one day, one afternoon, I had the iPhone in my pocket. She's doing this hula hoop. I said, we're going to show for people. And I took this. Most people that I showed to said, wow, that's a phone took that video? Well, it's HD. It's pretty good. It's not like what we sell at the shop. It's pretty good. So, you know, I think fundamentally we have to add value to things. And to make this as simple as possible, one of the ways that we can add value is with what David Gross was talking about here earlier, about just a little landing. When we went to doing a free inscription on the side of canvas prints, we have then changed the discussion from your canvas print is much more expensive than I saw in Snapfish to what would you like on the side of your canvas? Where do you want your signature? We changed the discussion about the nature of buying your canvas print. This is a simple value. Well, this can be done with video. So, listen, I'm me, I own the company, so I guess that my staff sometimes wants to please me. But I'll tell you that this transaction to go from me taping that video on the iPhone to what I'm about to show you was only, hey Rob was my video guy. I shot this thing, I want to do something with it, and I like this piece of music. So, take a look at this. Thank you.
I cried like the first 10 times I saw that thing. You know, it's like, are you kidding me? And this I'm going to touch on a little bit as well. But there's a look that she gives at the end. It's just precisely like my mother. I mean, isn't that what we do? Isn't that what we're doing? Yeah. Well, so to take it a step beyond, if we get into a transactional model with people, or rather a consultative model, and we begin to become the caretaker for those, for their images, other things can come about. Okay, so that's just a clip on an iPhone that seemed to work out well with this piece of music. There was no lighting. I'm not a video guy. I never videoed a wedding in my life. I just was there. It was something that was important to me. I captured it. Now I got something to show and relive all the time. Well, I also recently went back and had a bunch of my family's Super 8 movies transferred. And when they were done, in planning for this video revolution that we intend on doing, I said I want them prepared in editable files for iMovie. So they gave me MP4B, whatever. And I said, look, why don't you look through them and see if there's anything that we might be able to use in our promotion of video services. And the next thing I know, I walk into my shop, we got a couple of video monitors. Remember, it's about cues in theater. If you're doing video and you're not showing video, kind of a problem. It'd be like having a clothing shop with no clothes on the floor. So we put these videos in. I come into work one day. That's my brother, all right? I couldn't do it. And, you know, I look at these things. There's my dad playing pinball in the background. And the technology part of getting to this was not that difficult. It's the human part. So we've been given, you know, we started this whole deal. And you push the button and we do the rest. But I think it needs to be modified just a little bit. And I think this is the formula we need to follow. You give us your pictures and you give us some permission. Just give us pictures and give us your permission. And we will thrill you in a way that you cannot be prepared for. How many people have had people cry when you deliver photo files in your shop? Give us your pictures and give us permission and we will freak you out. For real. So, well, when you adopt that kind of thing, it comes about world high. How much are you willing to do? How much digging are you going to do? Well, first of all, you have to be profitable. There has to be a way to do it. I think there needs to be systems set up, but within that system, we need to allow our creative people to the ability to work with customers and maneuver them into solutions that's good for them, but one where we still get paid. So, how much is enough? I'll tell you, as much as it takes. How many of you are familiar with Lulu? They do photo books, right? Well, there's a ton of people doing good photo books. I'm sure you could lay out a great photo book with them, just like you could come to us. But they even go to the point on their publishing side where if you write a book, they started out as a place where you could write a book, and then you could order fewer copies than a traditional publisher would have you do. And now they're going in to selling you packages where there is proofreading, ghostwriting help, marketing, promotion, public relations. You literally can go to them and buy a package that encompasses the entire universe of becoming a published author. That's, I assure you, nobody woke up that day and said, you're Jesus because it's easy to do. They did it because that's what kind of service culture it takes now to win. You can't take work in and give it back. We have to invest part of ourselves. This is something that's coming. So I showed this image. This was taken in December of 2010. The city of New Orleans taking an aerial shot. got a phone call from a customer of mine, actually his wife, and his wife said, Michael wants something to put on the wall of his office. And I was thinking about an aerial shot or a skyline shot of the city of New Orleans. Now, for those of us that have been there, and he does home financing and stuff like that. For those of us that went through Katrina and seen kind of the city rebirth, this is a neat image. So, but when I looked, one of her requirements was, she said, I don't want any blue park photos. And what that means, if you come down there, you know, because when Katrina passed over, so much overhead views were taken at the blue park. She doesn't want that. She wanted not an old picture of New Orleans, but as it is today, without blue park. So I got online, I searched a couple of places. There was one place in San Francisco that had, like, aerial shots, so I inquired about one that I thought might work. I never heard back from them. Get this. I ended up talking to a few people. You know anybody who's been up to shoot an aerial? Guy goes, look, I'll just hire a student pilot. It'll cost you $300. You want me to go up? I can do it Thursday. It's a good time of year. I'm like, fine. Let me tell you, I've got New Orleans covered, including my house, better than Google Maps. This dude went up and shot everything. In that, he gets this one deal. So we go back and start to put our mojo on. And this is the installation, right? This thing is pretty big. That's this guy, right? His wife calls to inquire. We send a pilot up? We sent a pilot up to get a picture that a customer might want? This is a film lens. And this is an old film lens. That's where we come from. So we'll do whatever it takes within reason, you know? And this one worked out, and it was sort of a feather in our cap. I got to tell you, this past week before we came out here, this guy came in and dropped his game on hardware. We're going to deliver. You'll be happy. We're going to deliver, but we own it. And he's happy to be owned, right? That's the question. So, if winning isn't important, why keep score? If we're going to raise the average sale, if we are going to do things that require discretionary effort, if we are going to work with people in a consultative fashion, and we are going to employ young people, which most of us have to do, or anyone for that matter, how do we ensure that their eyes are on the right thing? I can only speak as a camera shop, because I got cameras and that. And for the longest time, it would bother me that they wouldn't pay as much attention to the service transactions as they would the hardware transactions. And there was a very simple reason for this. They were getting stiffs on cameras and accessories and not on services. And if they were, it wasn't equal. The salesperson made up their mind that really I'm going to hang over by this camera counter because it's still a problem. They had to switch the game. It's a new game for us, it's a new game for you. We elevated the services as where they would get the meat of their extra income, and very quickly you see them start to adjust their behavior patterns. So, the next thing we came up with is, why don't we have some kind of a target? We came up with the idea, and this kicks off this month, that if you get a $50 services transaction, a $50 ticket, any $50 ticket enters you into a drawing where the winner who has the most tickets is going to get something, but also each one that you get enters you in a drawing, so there'll be a drawing for the second. So we want to keep people in the hunt. And the focus will be on $50 service transactions. That keeps them away from just APM prints. Could say it needs to be 100, that's fine. Pick whatever you want to pick, but let's set a goal. We implemented that. I go to the circus with my kids, the Barnum & Bailey Circus, and I learned a lot about marketing from those people. Let me tell you, the greatest show on earth I found, you can't look without seeing that stuff. Whether they're showing it with light or on the head of an elephant or whatever. But they're very insistent. They tattoo the kids with that thing. They make the kids shout Barnum in order to free a clown. So they are really intent on having you remember who circus you just saw. So I got this image, and I thought it was pretty neat. And honestly, I really wanted to, I am a photographer. I like to take pictures. I really just wanted to see the thing big. So I printed a 40 by 50. Which is a little wasteful, but I mean, if I can't have a little fun with this, I don't know why I'm in this business, right? So I print this thing, and people like it. They go, oh, that's cool. And I thought, okay, how much I have to go to First Management Information. I'm going to be here. So how much does this 45-50 cost us, and what do you think we could sell for that would be exciting? She comes back. You know, I'll tell you something about her. And since she does offhand something, she factors in everything. The equipment, the clip, the labor, the material, and frankly, the cost is too high. That's okay, you don't need money. You have to add all these things in. So her figure was 35. So okay, we're gonna sell $50 standard for 40x60. $50 standard 40x60. Now, what are we doing now? We just changed the discussion. I gave my staff, who was in a contest for $50 service loans, an example. I gave them a tool. I gave them a pair of pliers to put in their toolbox. There's a ton of tools in the toolbox around the store now. We have a lot. You don't have to look around for a $50 product. We have a lot of it. It's not expensive, but we have average ticket, things that can support raising the average ticket. It's going to be awfully hard to raise the average ticket if you don't have products around that are actually higher priced than the stuff you've been selling. It's kind of tough to do it. So we looked at this thing and said, all right, fine. We're going to do $50 for the month of July, $50 for 40x60. So every evening when we close, I get a call from the closing manager, whoever they say to call, and they give me the end of the day total. Gives me an opportunity to say, what's wrong with y'all? How was your day? Do you have any problems? How are you doing? Whatever. And I also get to know, and then I put that day to bed, which was bad, and then go into the next. Well, that night, I talked to Craig. He called me, and he said, I was with such and such today. And he said, I still have run it for 40x60 cents. I was like, man, that's awesome, because he's the kind of guy. He's not a legacy employee. He didn't come in taking roles of sense. He came in once we had kind of switched it and put the services on equal footing with hardware. He's the guy who recognizes that you're printing wedding images and shows you the albums and sells the albums because he knows it's contributing to his service goal and so on. He knows this game. So when I threw this tool out, he leveraged it. Right? So I said, yeah, that's great. What happened? Did they get anything else with it? He says, oh, yeah. Yeah, he mounted it. And I'm like, well, how much was the ticket? He goes, I don't know, $280 or something. I was like, yeah, we got it, you know? Because, I mean, it's simple, right? How long has the live format inkjet been sitting in our store, right? It's been money machine. We had to create a way where the customer could say, oh, that's a cool image. How much is that? $50. I got an image. Let's go. Let's do it. And then, of course, where are you going to find the mat amount for 40x50? That's a tough proposition. So it's kind of cool, you know? Anyway, we go to the circus, and it dawned on me also that this is, as long as we have this, right? As long as we have people recording peak moments in their lives and peak things for their children, there's an interest in what we do. We just have to somehow gain clarity over the offering and sell things at a price point that can support a normal business. I don't think that's too much to ask. I stood in front of my staff and we talked about changing goals sometime back and asked them, how many of you get a manicure and a pedicure? You know, some hands went up, and I said, well, how much is a manicure and a pedicure? I'm like, $50, $75. Now, wait a minute. We had a situation where when we would say it's $39 an hour to work with us on a photo project, our people were afraid to say that. So we could take your family heirloom, maybe the only picture of your grandmother you own, maybe work on something with you. The $39 is too expensive, but you'll have some weirdo rub your feet and paint your toes for $50? You're kidding me? How is this possible? How is this possible that we have taken something that is so emotionally charged, so important to us, and so fundamental, and allowed it to be relegated to the realm of 19th century? Tell me how we have allowed that to occur. I don't know, but I'm not going to let it stand, at least not in my speech. So, there's something else about that circus. They said one of the elephants died, but I didn't notice anything. So, Let me follow up on something. This is critical. I'm going to leave you. I wrote on Mother's Day morning, sat down and wrote an essay about this development that happened in my home. And I'm going to ask if you can help me with these things out, but it's about execution. The stakes are unbelievably high when we touch an item that has personal meaning and is meant for an event or a reunion or a birthday party or something. We absolutely have to deliver. It has to be right. It has to be good. It has to be flattering. So one of the reasons I value this person that's with me so much is this email gets sent after I told her about it. Like, look, it's great that we did that, but when that thing comes out, that man needs to be freaked out happy. And if he is, he's coming back for another one. Then we talk about speed. I've heard a lot about this model where, man, if we only had the right software that could link up with a central lab, everybody could offer things that they wouldn't have to make themselves. There's only one problem with that. That's the speed problem. If you put yourself in a situation where you're reliant on the mail or on shipping, you are no more competitive than Snapfish or Shutterfly, which probably has better software to execute the problem than you do, execute the transaction than you do. That's why we went to stocking frames. That's why we went to stocking standard canvas frames. That's why you have the glass on hand. When you need something, you're going to get it. So I had a situation last week. A customer of mine had bought a big canvas print to go above his name. Big. Beautiful job he did. He showed it to me, a picture of it above his mantle. His father died last year. We did some memorial service stuff for him. That was good too. Then he comes in with this old folio, like the Roosevelt Hotel or something in New Orleans, where they may have had this in Newtown where they go around with a 4x5 camera and shoot the black and white picture away. So this is his parents, right? It was yellow. There was somebody else in the industry writing it there. It was right before Father's Day. I knew this was an important time for him. So I said, well, look, let me see what I can do. I'll get to it. So I tweaked it up, and I thought right away, because it was easy for me to suggest, I went right. He was asking about a canvas. I said, man, I don't think this is right for a canvas. I think we need something a little more elegant, a little more to the size of the original, something that will look good. I'm trying to outsell myself. I'm trying to make sales that wear well, right? I mean, that's part of our responsibility, is to make sales that wear well so that they feel good about what they've done with it and they come back. So I put this, ultimately, in one of those mix-and-match frames, a black frame, with the cream mat, one of my three choices, right? And I said, this is what we're going to do. I said, Mike, I'm going to restore the photo. You got the restoration. I've got the frame. I can put it in the frames on $49. Oh, man, that's fine. That's great. That's great. So I text him when it was done. And he's a big guy. He's an attorney. And I'm just in front of 40 rails on people. He comes to my office. He's crap. He looked at this thing and, it's like I've been there. It amazed me. He couldn't thank me enough. He really had to compose himself a couple of times. And we own him too. And he likes it. Ultimately, I started doing some, what is it, really? What is it? We know they're important to us. We always use the thing about you're running to a burning house to save the photo album because that's the most important. It's simple. It's fine. Brain is the record of the feelings of a life. It turns out, in our rush to be rational and to measure everything, we may be neglecting the most important part of us. I'm going to recommend a talk on TED. Many of you are familiar with TED, thoughts online. Just Google this, right? Google TED, David Brooks, the social animal. That's a line out of his film that talks about the power of emotion. And the fact of the matter is that there is nothing on the planet that you can show someone, assuming that it's a photograph of people that are important to them, that will call back the power of emotion, of love, of loss, of all those things, faster and more fully than a photograph. You sit on a powder keg of chalk and you deal with these things. That's how come when you get wrong an important project, it's bad, right? So we are no longer a printing service that prints TV and runs a lot from a lot. We're handling the stuff that's at the very root of our humanity. And we've cheapened it beyond belief. We need to reverse that course. So raising the average share is the appropriate thing. So let me get back to this. Thank you. So it's not, I don't think we're at the point that this is not a transactional model. We are not at the point now where we can just say, you push the button, you do the rest, although I think there's an important clue there, right? We can't expect to be a standalone output bureau where we put all of the creative and work on the customer. That's not what we are anymore. Part of what we are, but it's not fully what we are. I think the new one needs to be give us your pictures and give us permission so that we might suggest things that thrill you. And from there, we don't know what's going to come about. But you'll certainly like it, right? So, raise the average sale now. Seriously, if you do not have things on the walls that sell for higher price points, start to put them in. Make a start. So we're going to stop taking orders for output. We're going to start asking questions. We're going to act like a Sherpa, right? You're going to be the person that takes you to Everest with your photographs. And there's plenty of evidence to suggest that exceptional, out-of-the-box, send-a-plane-up-to-get-a-photograph service is taking root across many industries. Two of these slides come from the WPPI show for service providers who are in our industry but not precisely related, like Smug Mug and this I Love Photo Biz. They're offering passionate support. If you look at Rackspace, which is being rumored to potentially be Dell's Five, they purchased them, they have built their business on fanatical support. Their fanatical support is not the cheapest hosting on the planet. In fact, they make no bones about it. If you get what you work from them, it's fanatical support. When there's a bicycle company who largely does internet business where you want to ride a set of wheels and they're not right for you, they'll take them back no questions asked. Because that's what it takes to interface with consumers. We cannot set up rules and expect them to follow them. We have to work with them in an effort to thrill them. So I think, ultimately, there's probably two paths for us to go by at this point. You can either be the type of company that can move a lot of boxes efficiently, and there are some people here that have those kind of operations. I would say we're close in some ways on our camera side, but we're not the kind of place that really can move tonnage and work on small margins and make a great life out of it. I don't think that's us. We have to be really special. And the good news is that there's a place for us to be special. We have products like the film and gear that can fill out our stores with a lot of variety. We're sitting on the most powerful stuff that humans have. We just have to execute it. So with that, I'm going to encourage you to go home, start billing for what you do, start thrilling people, and let's build this new business. Thank you for having me here.
Dave, I definitely see a jar out of this somewhere. I'm not sure where, but I'll find one somewhere. Anyway, one announcement I wanted to make, which I think we all need to take just a moment and say hello. Just received a text that Phil Gresham is watching a live stream. So, hi, Phil! Yeah, get back to work now. He texted us and told us that it was much easier staying up than flying over here. Whatever time. What time is it over there, Stuart? What time is it over there? Which day? I gotta tell you this. So I'm over in Sydney a few weeks ago. Looking at this deal with Stuart and Rob. It's Sunday afternoon, and I call Fran, and I said, Fran, did you go to church today? And she says, no. I said, why not? She says, because it's Saturday. Thinking, oh, God. How stupid. Anyway, yeah, that's really, really confusing. So coming back, I leave on Tuesday morning at 10 a.m. and I get in LAX Tuesday morning at 7 a.m. So I got 3 hours to kill that I can just do anything I want that are not even relevant to the rest of my life. But it's, yeah, that's really, really, really confusing. Anyway, next we're going to have Ron talk a little bit about his project where he's helping us fill these jars. And he's going to talk about IPI Development Labs. River Ron. Ron, come on up.
Just 1 minute. Yeah, thank you. Yeah?
No gallery.
Yeah, I'm trying to get this thing working so I can see what I'm looking at, but maybe that's not going to happen. This one?
No?
Yeah, this will work, I think. Let's see if we can change the slides. No. Hmm. There we go. Okay. We have this new project that Brent was talking about, and it's all around how do we take all this information and all the different things that are in our daily lives, and learning that you know, we sit in these conferences like this and we have all this information that comes by us, and we don't necessarily have you know, the information readily available when we go back to implement it. So we pick up, you know, have sideway conversations in the halls, and we have these conferences we attend. We have our forums, and we have all these different input areas, and we don't really have a good way to collect all of that and utilize it in our daily lives. So using the term that Brent used earlier on jars, we actually have now renamed that and called it IPI Development Labs. And the development labs are the jars, and they're the 25 different areas of business that we want to look at and focus on and put all of our efforts around grabbing everything that we need in order to effectively implement that and put it into one container or jar, as Brent discusses. So right now we do have 25 models planned, and each one of those at planned at estimated $40,000 a piece, and we believe that that's probably a low estimate, and especially if you look at some of the ones that we have in place right now. So, well, we're still having trouble getting these slides to move with us. It's moving up here, but not there. Well, how do we, I'm sorry? You think? Okay. So right now, if you attended the, we had three sessions today that we actually started introducing the development labs. One was in custom framing, and you may have received books like this. Another was video services, and they actually have a cover called Business Blueprints, and Brent is going to talk about that in just a few moments. And then sports and event photography. So what we've done is taken the information that we have around each one of these different jars and put them into this Development Labs program and capture them into this document so that when you're looking to implement this in your stores, your locations, you have one place to go to. And as we learn more and as we gather more knowledge, we'll add more knowledge and more information to these different documents. The first phase, and if you look at, I've got a couple of graphics here, we'll see if we can pull up. So if you look at the different components, I already discussed most of these, but there's just so much information out there. And what we're going to do in the first phase is, as we mentioned, put them in these printed containers so that you can effectively say, if I want to implement sports and event photography, what do I need?